Hi, and welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. I'm Debula. Coming up on today's program, coronavirus has become a worldwide pandemic. So what are the steps you can take to keep yourself safe?
When you're coughing, don't cough like anywhere. You cover your mouth or use a handkerchief.
With so much fake news circulating about the virus, we'll look at how you can sort the fact from the fiction. And we'll speak to a doctor to find out why children seem to be less hit by the coronavirus.
In children, there seem to be a masking of the symptoms, making the symptoms mild to almost asymptomatic.
We're starting the program this week with the coronavirus. You may have heard by now that there have been cases in countries across the continent. It's been declared a pandemic by the World Health Organization, which means when a disease is infectious and can pass easily from person to person in many parts of the world. Pandemics don't last forever though, and there's plenty we can do in our day-to-day lives to keep us safe. In a moment, we'll ask a doctor why children aren't being so affected by the virus. But first, Christine has been hanging out in one school in Nairobi to find out what children there are being taught about fighting coronavirus.
So there's a lot of misinformation about what coronavirus is out there and how people catch it. So what are some of the things that you need to do to keep yourself safe? Today, I'm in a school in Nairobi to speak to the pupils and find out what do they know about the virus and what are the teachers doing to the spread of both the virus and the fake news.
I have heard that coronavirus is a large family of viruses that causes an illness. It originated from China at a city called Wuhan.
I've heard that coronavirus is a deadly disease and it spreads through contacts of the hands and skin.
The symptoms of the virus are headache, shortness of breath, cough, kidney failure, and fever.
Since the first reported case in December in China, the virus has spread across the globe. Understandably, parents are concerned what measures are being taken to keep their children safe in school.
Some of the measures the school is taking, one, we are educating the children on the coronavirus issue. The first thing is that we have not accepted and we have not allowed any child to do the handshaking. When they are doing their greetings, they do it orally. Number two, we have installed every washroom with liquid soap that they use each and every time, and we've instructed they thoroughly wash their hands. Number three, we have also told them to avoid rubbing their faces with hands and washed hands, because those are some of the measures that we can take to avoid all this.
In school, we were told on how to prevent it. When you're coughing, don't cough like anywhere. You cover your mouth or use a handkerchief.
So how do you guys say hi? If I do this? Hey, and you? So even me from today, I do?
So how does all this affect how the children feel about the coronavirus?
We are not worried because our sanitation department and the club have organized soaps, cleanliness in the washrooms and in classes.
So the lessons here are busting myths and helping the kids feel less anxious when it comes to the virus. The tips that they're getting on hygiene are vital to make sure that coronavirus does not spread even quicker around the world.
Thanks, Christine. Since we filmed that piece, the government there has closed schools to try and stop the virus spreading. Things are moving very quickly though, and more infections are being reported in some countries in Africa, including Kenya. So how are people keeping up with their education? Well, at home, back to Christine.
Thank you, Debula. As you have said, the situation has been changing rapidly. President Uhuru Kenyatta suspended learning in all education institutions in Kenya, and this will obviously affect learning progress. So what are some of the schools doing? I'm in the studio to speak to the principal of Brookhouse School, who have taken the lead in virtual learning. Hi, Mr. Mulindi.
Hi, Christine. Good to be speaking to you.
We're glad to have you. So just tell me, The closing of schools, how has this affected Brookhouse as an institution?
I'm very, very pleased to say that it hasn't disrupted learning at all. President Kenyatta announced the closure of public schools on Sunday evening, and by Monday morning, everything was as per normal school because we managed to go onto our virtual learning platform. And as I speak, teachers are delivering lessons from home. The children are at home, but the school day is running on the virtual platform almost as a mirror of what would be happening in the normal school day.
How well prepared were you for this? Because it seems like you guys were very prepared for this.
We did refresher courses for the staff. We prepared the children. We made sure the parents were aware that we could go into virtual learning at any one time. So one of the things we did was to make sure that students had devices. In this particular regard, we are talking about laptops. We also made sure that teachers were able to do what we call blended learning. So they were using the traditional print approach to learning as well as digital technologies.
So far, how are the kids taking it?
We've had, I would say, 98% attendance because we are marking registers as normal. And they're very, very enthusiastic. We have options where teachers interact by video conferencing and then move on to other platforms where they can do assignments and they can feedback.
Thank you, Mr. Mulindi. And that's it from Nairobi. Back to you, Debula.
Now, the coronavirus outbreak has sparked what the World Health Organization is calling an infodemic. That's an overwhelming amount of information on social media and websites. Some of it is accurate and some is downright untrue. Here's Fatia debunking some of the myths and misinformation.
Coronavirus outbreak has sparked fear and despair. Well, so far there is no cure, and as they say, prevention is better than cure. But is everything you see online true, or are we grappling with an infodemic? Well, infodemic is not a word you find in the English dictionary. Call it a new word, but in this context, it's the short form of information and pandemic equals to infodemic, meaning there's lack of clear information with regard to COVID-19. Let's look at three prevention claims. Claim one, garlic water cures coronavirus. According to a Facebook post by DXN Way of Health, coronavirus can be cured by one bowl of freshly boiled garlic water. This post was circulated widely in Africa's most populous nation, Nigeria. But is this factual?
Not true. There is no evidence, scientific evidence so far, that shows that garlic water can cure coronavirus infections.
Claim two, face masks don't work. Face masks are now scarce due to the sudden surge in demand globally from the onset of the coronavirus outbreak. But does this mean you are not at risk of contracting the virus if you have a mask on?
Not true. Face masks are actually quite important if you have coronavirus because it's transmitted through droplets from sick people. And that means that if you've got a face mask, at least it keeps them away from getting to other people. Secondly, if you are taking care of a person who has COVID-19, then having a face mask would help you not get the droplets that would eventually get you the disease.
Claim three, Africans have strong genes, they cannot be infected. This claim has been a major talking point across the continent and widely shared. But does the genetic makeup of Africans make them immune to COVID-19?
Not true. There's no scientific evidence at the moment that shows that Africans are strong against the virus.
With all said and done, we are bombarded with so much information about the disease. But how can we factually protect ourselves from COVID-19?
The way to protect yourself is to wash your hands with alcohol-based substances or with soap and water. and also to avoid touching your nose, your mouth, or your eyes, which can be the places where the virus would get to. Secondly, if you have COVID-19 or you are a suspect case of the disease, then wearing a mask is really helpful because then it helps you not pass the droplets that could be infected to other people. And if you are caring for a person that has a suspect case of COVID-19, then also wearing a mask could be helpful for you because then that keeps away the droplets that could be infected away from getting from you.
As we've seen, there's a lot of misinformation out there about the virus. And the best people to get the right information from are the experts. Tomasina has been tracking down one for us.
Thanks, Dabula. That's right. When a virus breaks out, the best people to speak to are virologists. Virologists can be both practicing doctors and researchers working on finding preventions for the virus. So here with us today, we have Dr. Oluwatosin, and she is a virologist in Nigeria. Hi, Dr. Oluwatosin.
Hi, Tomasina.
So, how does this virus affect children?
So far, the new coronavirus, or I would refer to it as COVID-19, affects children, but children seem to be less infected than adults. It has been suggested that the rate of infection in children is just equal to what we have in adults, but in children there seem to be a masking of the symptoms, making the symptoms mild to almost asymptomatic. So sometimes children don't even display any of these symptoms, or when they do, you have the symptoms mild.
Okay, so you've mentioned the symptoms. What should children at home look out for?
Similar to the respiratory virus and respiratory infection symptoms, you have the fever, the cough, the runny nose. You could also have the severe cases, breathing difficulty, but that's just in severe cases. These symptoms could be accompanied with a sore throat.
And how can children best protect themselves from getting coronavirus?
First of all, children need to be educated on how to protect themselves, because I believe that every child has a caregiver or a parent around them. So they should protect themselves by washing their hands. Hand washing is one of the first prevention tips for preventing the new coronavirus. And then covering the nose while sneezing or coughing. There's a method that is proposed, not using the bare hands to cover the nose, but using the elbow. So it's called the Dracula method. So you cough or sneeze into your elbow.
And how well do you think Nigeria is prepared for this outbreak?
I believe that the health system in Nigeria is prepared for this outbreak. Yesterday, my nephew came back home and said to his mom, "Mommy, I need a hand sanitizer." And we asked him, "Why do you need a hand sanitizer?" He said he told them at school, to sanitize their hands. So I believe that at every sector and at every level, in schools, in the health sector, everyone is right about now on alert.
Thank you, Dr. Oluwatosin.
Thank you so much.
So the main steps to keeping yourself safe is to keep washing your hands and to not touch your face. Back over to you, Dabula, in the studio.
Now, whilst for many people it's an anxious time, lots of people have been keen to reassure young people and show their charitable sides. Here's a few stories. First up, in Norway, the government has held a coronavirus press conference with a difference. All the questions were asked by children. No adult journalists were allowed, and instead, kids from around the country were invited to submit their questions, which were then read out. The Prime Minister said it was allowed to be a bit scared, but said just because children weren't at school, it doesn't mean you shouldn't learn things. Next up, many people have also been working out how they can best help others during the coronavirus outbreak. This couple in Scotland, who run a shop, have been delivering items such as hand sanitizer and face masks to vulnerable and elderly people in the community for free. It's costing the business around $2,500, but the owners say they just want to assist their customers. Aww. And people in Spain have been showing their gratitude to health workers by going onto their balconies and leaning out of their windows and clapping and cheering. The campaign was launched on social media so people could express their gratitude. People there have been ordered to stay home for 2 weeks unless they have to go to work, hospital, or buy food or medicine. Now, when I think of Morocco, I think about the country's food, things like the tasty tagines and delicious couscous. Its cuisine is famous worldwide, and for a good reason. And now one young chef is bringing it to even more people through social media. Chef Omar has almost 150,000 fans on Facebook who love his easy-to-make recipes. The 14-year-old has done all this whilst living with muscular conditions, which means he has to use a wheelchair. So how does he manage his disability whilst also being an internet superstar? Nora went to meet him in Casablanca.
Morocco is known for its tasty tagines and its couscous. And right now, we're going to tuck into some malouma, which is a Moroccan Jewish dish. Now, our next guest, he's also passionate about food. He's called Chef Omar and he's become a hit on YouTube. He also has a condition called muscular dystrophy, which he'll tell us more about in our report. So let's see what he's got on the menu today.
Hello, everybody. Today, we're making steak with turkey and pasta. Let's do it. Lubna!
Yes.
Do you know who's Lubna? It's my mom and my assistant. My name is Chef Omar. I am 14 years old, and what I like to do is that I like to cook. So what we're gonna do is that we're gonna take the steak, we're gonna put turkey on it, and then we're gonna flip it, and then we're gonna put this sharp thing, which I say to little kids to not use unless there is a guardian next to them. So my mom helps me by helping me make the video at first. Then, like, if I can do some things, she helps me to cook in the oven or over the fire, of course. And that's why children shouldn't play with fire. Open it. Put some butter in it. I have a muscular dystrophy, which is that I have muscles, but I don't have that much to step with my feet and stand up.
Hey, you, tout le monde. Devinez qui je suis. Je suis Chef Omar.
I started to cook when I had 8 years old. It started from my mom and the doctor. The doctor told me, can you use your hand? Because you need to use your muscles. So my first dish was sushi. Then I started from my mom's Facebook page. And then I told her, now I'm watching YouTube. I want people to see me too. Wow. I like cooking because I like to eat, but my mom makes me cook healthy stuff, which every kid dislikes. So I put something that I like and something that my moms tell me to put in the recipe. Could you please put some salt and pepper? And now we're gonna put some argan oil. I do sometimes say that my dystrophy, I didn't want it because it doesn't help me, like, playing soccer or basketball or like tennis. But I also like it because it helped me knowing that life is a test given by God. Oh my God, it smells so nice because of the argan oil that comes directly from Morocco. So each of my recipes, I put something Moroccan. And this dish, I put argan oil. The chef that inspired me at first was Choumicha, which was a famous Moroccan chef which opened a restaurant in Dubai. And what I would like to do is I would like to meet Gordon Ramsay. Don't forget to keep smile and keep hope and the positive attitude, which are the three best things in life.
We first met our next guest a few weeks back. He's an artist and a celebrity in his own right. Kenwa Jobu has worked with musicians such as Burna Boy and American producer Swizz Beatz and uses his art to tackle issues of the society, aiming to give a voice to the voiceless. He recently won an award in Nigeria for Best Creativity in Art and refers to himself as a contemporary realist. What's that? Wonder no more if I turn along to his exhibition in London.
Right in the center of London, the sign Contemporary Realism has got people intrigued. Ken Wanjogu is internationally known for art that challenges social and political issues. So what is contemporary realism? And is he the pioneer of this new style of art?
Yeah, basically, we check Google, I'm the only one that has it. Contemporary realism is basically a fusion of hyperrealism and contemporary art. All you want to do is look at my works, see how good they are. Oh, it looks like a person. Oh, it looks like a face. Oh, look at the eyes, right? Mm-hmm. But then you miss the message. You miss why is there identity written, danger written, crisis written, Twitter written. Okay. So what I want you to do is look at my work. Yes, it's realistic, but look at all the things that, you know, happen around it. So I call it contemporary realism, you know, fusing contemporary art and hyperrealism together.
What's behind
this? This is Twitter. So one thing I understood about social media, eventually, you know, these applications creep into you, right? And all you want to do is appeal to the followers that you have. Now, this is one of the biggest problems of depression in the world. I see young people being obsessed with social media, being obsessed with the likes and the followership. And if this piece can stop one person from depression, why won't I do it?
You've also been spotted by celebrities.
Yeah. M.I., Burna Boy, Don Jazzy, loads of them.
How did that come about?
At the early part of my career, all I wanted to do was to give these musicians that due respect, the fact that they've inspired me in different ways. Mm. So I did a couple of works for Burna Boy. I did the first work for Burna Boy. He called me the next time for his album cover, which was something I really put my mind into.
Which album was that?
I'm on a spaceship, so the idea was he's meant to stand, you know, his clothes off, but he has the space suits, and he has the space helmet, and he has a space glove. I had to snap a picture of him, and I had to use my idea of, you know, understanding, perspective, and, you know, design to create that space suit on him.
Let's take a look at some more of your work.
Definitely.
What's the story behind this?
Yeah, it's called Too Much Talk, Not the Full Basket. So it's from a Fela song. You know, this is an Adinkra symbol from Ghana. Mm-hmm. But they are in four parts, 1, 2, 3, 4, meaning wisdom. And that was the one thing I got from the song that was one of the wisest things I could think of. You figure out that people say loads and loads of things, but nobody wants to do anything. So too much talk, when you're speaking too much, you see why the mouth is covered. You know, it's not, it can't fill a basket.
So what are you trying to achieve with your art?
An experience. I want you to experience nature. I want you to experience life, the society. And I want you to show empathy. I want you to put yourself in his shoes. I want you to put yourself in his shoes. And that's what I do in my art. I'm trying as much as possible to make the world a better place.
That's all from the BBC What's New team this week. We'll see you next time. Bye.